He rules the world with a staff and a rod. We're a team, me and God. All right, good morning. I am so looking forward to this lesson. It's just going to be an introduction into your and mine, our wedding day. It's an introduction to the timing of the wedding. There is so much confusion in the church in regards to what Father is allowing us to know before the unsealing of the wisdom concerning the 70th week, what we will know. We know that no one knows the exact day and hour of Jesus's return. This again is going to be an introduction, and then we're going to go more in detail over the weeks and months. But I'm going to share with you what I've read in Father's Word, where I've read it, my interpretations based on the Holy Spirit helping me, and we may not know until the Lord returns who's right and who's wrong, but any wisdom that I have been given is from Father, is from His Spirit, and remember, He uses the foolish things of the earth to bring down the haughty people who think they are wise. So as low as I am on the totem pole of people on this planet, that just ups the chances that He may have gave me a little bit of understanding. So those of you who have your 6 or more years of seminary, there's nothing wrong with that. That's a beautiful thing. But you can't have a better teacher than the Holy Spirit. Okay, enough said about that. The introduction today, we'll start with the actual wedding day. We've talked about it a little bit in previous videos when we looked at Matthew 22 and tied that into Galatians. We're going to go into all of these prophecies dealing with the number of days during the 70th week. There is so much that we can know now, even though we don't know the exact day and the hour yet. Father is begging you to go into His Word, study it, be a detective, see what you can find out, find the golden nuggets. He's begging you to spend time to eagerly, eagerly look for the coming of the kingdom. He has given us so much information. We're going to look at the 2,300-day prophecy, the 1,335-day prophecy, the 1,290-day prophecy, the 1,260-day prophecy. We're going to look at how long the seventh trumpet lasts. We're going to find out as much as we can, but again, this video, which hopefully will be no longer than 30 or 40 minutes, is just an introduction. It's going to whet your appetite to get into Father's Word and prove me wrong. Prove me wrong. And don't prove me wrong because 99% of Christians may believe a certain way. Get into Father's Word, but don't grab a verse. Brothers and sisters, whatever you do, don't be one of those people that say, shoot me a verse. Aha! See what I found? No, you read the entire chapter in context. And if you really do that, you will be amazed at how many chapters throughout all the Old and New Testament give you clues towards the day of the Lord, that day, the 70th week of Daniel. You'll be amazed. There's clues all throughout the Bible to be found. They're not just a bunch of history lessons. There's things that the church, the beloved, the blessed, can use to know and to strengthen your faith. All right, where do we find the most about our wedding day? Well, it's Revelation chapter 19. I think most of us already know that. That is when Jesus returns. That's when His bride is gathered up. That's the seventh bowl. That's right, brothers and sisters, the seventh bowl, the end of the age, the end of the seventh trumpet period is when Jesus will return. That's the Valley of Armageddon, the Valley of Megiddo, the Valley of Jezreel, okay, in northern Israel. We're talking about the time when all of the nations on the planet have representatives and armies and kings and commanders in place for the wedding. They may not realize they're there for the wedding, but they're invited guests, and we see that that's exactly what the bowls of wrath, all seven of them, which make up the seventh trumpet period, that is what they're all about. Okay, yes, Father is finishing pouring out his wrath on the Middle East, on Israel, on those who come against Israel, all the above. Everyone's going to taste of the cup of madness. They're going to drink of it. But the main purpose of the bowls of wrath are used to gather the nations to the wedding hall that you read about in Matthew 22, the invited guest. They're called to the wedding. Yes, the bad and good are called to the wedding. But don't confuse that with the actual wedding that immediately follows. In a twinkling of an eye, when Jesus breaks through the atmosphere into the physical realm, he will send forth his angels to gather the elected ones, the blessed, the chosen, the brethren, the faithful. These are the ones who were foreknew to God before the foundations of the earth. Father predestined these souls to be drawn to Jesus. Okay? We're talking about those who lived thousands of years ago, as well as the ones that are going to be alive at his coming. You have the resurrected ones and the translated living. All is going to occur at the same time. Yes? Yes, the Bible says that Father will bring back those souls with him. But he is going to unite them with their new glorified body as he breaks through the atmosphere and sounds not the seventh trumpet, the last trumpet. The seventh trumpet starts the bowls of wrath period, and it lasts 45 days long. Okay, we'll introduce you to that in a second. Now, at the end of the seventh trumpet period, that is the wedding day, that is the seventh bowl. Okay, the seventh bowl is chapter 19, but if you want to read more about what's going on as far as things falling from the sky and the earth shaking and all that, go back to Revelation chapter 16, verse 17. That's where we start the wedding day, the seventh bowl. All right, you can read all about that, verse 17 through 21. The greatest earthquake of all times, the greatest hailstorm of all times, you can read about it there. Now, while you're there, please take note of Revelation 16:15. Okay, 16:16 explains to you where the wedding takes place, the wedding hall. It's the Valley of Armageddon. But 16:15, the verse before that, in red letters, hello church, red letters, Jesus says, behold, I am coming as a thief. Blessed is he who watches and keeps his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. Okay? There is no rapture, church. This right here should get your attention. You're still waiting to be gathered. The bride is still waiting to be gathered to Jesus. All right, there's not two comings, beloved. There's not. There's one coming. All right, it's at the seventh bowl. And here is just one of your clues, Revelation 16:15. He hasn't come yet. He's coming as a thief. When does he come? Two verses later, at the seventh bowl. at the Battle of Armageddon. Okay, take note of that. Now again, we've introduced you to the fact that the seventh, I say we, it's myself and the Holy Spirit, we have introduced you to the fact that the seventh trumpet is 45 days long, ending with the seventh bowl, the day of the wedding when Jesus breaks forth into the atmosphere, through the atmosphere, into the physical realm, on that cloud, that magnificent cloud with power and glory. And all of those people are gathered below the cloud. And then those with the wedding garments are taken up to the cloud. Okay. First, of course, within the twinkling of an eye, there they are, all of the dead who were slept in Christ are gathered. And then right behind them, in the same twinkling of an eye, those with the wedding garments on, standing in the, throughout the earth, but also in the Valley of Armageddon, will be those with the wedding garments, who are also part of the bride. They will be snatched up. And then those who are in the Valley of Armageddon, who are not part of the bride, will notice that they were left behind, which will be the majority, will be standing there, but they'll know. They'll see Jesus. They'll know they were left behind. They'll know that the time has come, that the angels were sent forth to gather. Somehow they'll be able to tell. And they'll know they were left behind. And there'll be probably millions of people gathered there who will wonder why. You know, why God, why Allah, why whoever, why did you not take me? There'll be wailing and gnashing of teeth. But that seventh bowl, we are told in Daniel, again, this is just an introduction, but we're going to go over there and take a look at it. You could actually start counting from the abomination of desolation. Start counting at the abomination of desolation. We do not know yet when that's going to take place, but when it does, you will know the day that your Lord returns. You know the day of your wedding. In fact, you can actually start counting from the event that triggers the 2,300-day prophecy near the front part of the 70th week, the 7-year tribulation. We'll look at that. But from the abomination of desolation to the wedding, which is the seventh bowl in chapter 16 of Revelation, it goes more in detail at Revelation chapter 19. That's your wedding, day 1,335. That's when you will arise if you sleep in Christ and your soul's in heaven, but you've already passed. You will arise to your inheritance on that day, 1,335, from the abomination of desolation. Fine. Okay, now we know what the 1,335 is. What is the 1,290 days? Do they have the same starting date? Do they have the same ending date? What is the event that triggers it? Well, the 1,290 days starts the same time as the 1,335 days prophecy. They have the same starting point, but not the same ending point. Okay, what's the difference? 45 days difference in their ending. Guess what? That's the same length of time as the seventh trumpet period bowls of wrath. So, day 1,290 starts at the abomination of desolation, but it ends at the sounding of the seventh trumpet. Did you catch that? Both the 1290 and the 1335 have the same start date, the abomination of desolation, when the Antichrist sets up the image in the temple, in the Jewish temple that has not been built yet. But we do not know that the temple has to be finished. pay attention to that. But we do know at least the sanctuary has to be completed. Okay. So they have the same starting point. The seventh trumpet sounds 1,290 days after the abomination of desolation. Then you have the last 45 days, which are the bowls of wrath, ending with the seventh bowl, which is our wedding day. It's a 24-hour day. All right, I'm going to show you in Father's Word where we know what time of day Jesus returns when he breaks through the atmosphere. It's actually at evening, at dusk, the same time that throughout history Israel has considered their new day beginning. It's at the end of the day starts the new day. And we'll see in Father's Word that's when the wedding takes place. We'll look at that in Isaiah in just a second. But so that's your 1290 and your 1335. And you might say, why isn't the last trumpet the seventh trumpet? Well, we're going to look in Daniel chapter 7. Daniel chapter 7 says that there is a court that's going to be adjourned. It's going to be in session. The court is in session to see if Father is going to award the kingdom to the saints. Why? Because we see in Revelation 12:11 that the saints have to overcome the devil as Jesus overcome the devil. There has to be a minimum number, and you read about this in Revelation chapter 6. The number has to be reached. There has to be a minimum number of those of the bride, of the elect, who are willing to die for Jesus as Jesus died for us. Okay? I sense skepticism. All right, let's go look at Revelation 12:11. So much of the church has missed this. Okay, you might think, well, Jesus paid it all. Yes, he paid it all. But that court in Daniel 7, you need to read about what's going on in that court. Because they do come to a verdict. Father awards the kingdom to the saints and the saints' groom, Jesus. So the seventh trumpet is sounded when the court has reached a verdict, awarding the kingdom to the saints. But guess what? Daniel 7 also says that it's not time to possess them yet. All right? Why? Because at the sounding of the seventh trumpet still has not yet bowed a knee to Jesus.
Well, guess what? Everything is going to be timed perfect. So before all flesh is destroyed from the planet, Israel will finally bow a knee to Jesus. Everything will be unsealed to the Jews, who at that point are going to be slaves helping to build the Antichrist kingdom, because Israel has already fell at that point. Jerusalem has already fell at this point. Those left alive have been taken away as slaves. Okay, in future videos, we'll research all of that. But when they finally bow a knee, just in time, the seventh bowl will be poured and Jesus will break through the atmosphere to gather his bride. But yes, in Revelation 12:11, this is what you need to understand why the court in Daniel 7 is even in session. This is why the court is in session. Then I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ have come, for the accuser of our brethren who accused them before our God day and night has been cast down, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives to the death. This is what the court in Daniel 7 is in session for. Everyone is watching to see if the minimum number mentioned in Revelation chapter 6, okay, the fifth seal, if enough of the bride is willing to die for Jesus, to be put on trial, probably on live television, and let the Holy Spirit speak through them during the trial, so the word can be preached throughout the ends of the earth. Why? Because guess what? Every nation on the planet today has television and satellites, relays, and these Christians, okay, with the Holy Spirit speaking in tongues, did you catch that? Speaking in tongues on trial at the fifth seal will be heard by every ethnic group in the world. Every country on the planet will hear them in their own language. Amen. That is what is meant by he cannot come until the gospel is spread throughout the earth. Revelation 12:11. That is why the court in Daniel 7 is in session. The seventh trumpet will sound, and Jesus will, Father will award the kingdom to the saints. But it is not time to possess the kingdom until 45 days later. Why? Just so Father can throw out a little bit more vengeance? No, because those unclean spirits that you read about in Revelation, sixth bowl. Remember the sixth bowl? Let's go back to Revelation chapter. Let's see. Here we go. Revelation 16, verse 12. Then the sixth angel poured out its bowl on the great river Euphrates, and its water was dried up so that the way of the kings from the east might be prepared. And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs coming out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. Does it say they're coming from Father? No, but it is his will that they, verse 14, are spirits of demons performing signs which go out to the kings of the earth and of the whole world to what? Gather them to the battle of the great day of God Almighty. Why? Because that's the wedding, the revealing of Jesus Christ as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. Amen. All right. We talked about the 1,335-day prophecy. We talked about the 1,290-day prophecy. We talked about the 45 days of the seventh trumpet period, which are the seven bowls. We talked about Jesus returning and the seventh bowl, the greatest earthquake and hailstorm of all time. Did you know that day that Jesus returns in the physical realm, our wedding day, has its own name? The last day of the day of the Lord period, which falls in this age, has a name called the day of his fierce anger. You read about it throughout the Bible, especially Isaiah 13. The day of his fierce anger, the last day of this age, which begins at evening time. The evening tide, when it rolls in, the time of evening where we start the new Jewish day, that's when Jesus returns. And by morning, all his enemies will be defeated. Now let's go take a look at what we find in Daniel, in the book of Daniel. Let's start with the 2,300-day prophecy. Turn to Daniel chapter 8.
But here, these two pages, you see Daniel 7 and you see Daniel 8 starting down here. This Daniel 7, you need to read about that. Okay? That is the court in heaven. Have you ever read it? Let's start with verse 8 and read a little bit of it, so you know what I'm talking about when I say the court in Daniel 7, the court in heaven. Verse 8, I was considering the horns, and there were another horn, a little one, coming up among them, before whom three of the first horns were plucked out by the roots. That's the Antichrist. And there in this horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking pompous words. Blasphemies. We know around mid-trib, that's when the Antichrist is in the temple speaking these things, setting up the image. It says, I watched till thrones were put in place. When does the court come in session? Mid-trib. When does the court reach a verdict? Seventh trumpet. Keep that in mind. From the fifth seal to the seventh trumpet, the court in heaven is in session. And the Ancient of Days, that's Father, was seated. His garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head was like pure wool. His throne was a fiery flame, its wheels a burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. 1,000 thousands ministered to him, 10,000s time. 10,000 stood before him. The court was seated, and the books were opened. And I watched then because of the sound of the pompous words which the horn was speaking. This is mid-trib. I watched until the beast was slain, seventh bowl, and its body destroyed and given to the burning flame. That's the battle of Armageddon. As for the rest of the beasts, they had their dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and a time. I was watching in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man, verse 13, coming with the clouds of heaven. All right, they're just telling you who is reporting to the court. This is the one who is reporting. Father has now summoned to the court this entity, and this is Jesus, capital O, one like the Son of Man, the same wording that you see in chapter 14 of the book of Revelation, one like the Son of Man. When the O is capitalized, okay, that's Jesus. And here he is reporting to the Ancient of Days. It says, this one, continuing on with verse 13, he came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Remember, the court's in session. Then to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom that all peoples, nations, languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion. All right, this is talking about the court verdict. Okay, we'll read more about that as we continue on in this same chapter, chapter 7. All right, verse 18, let's pick it up there. But the saints of the Most High shall receive the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, even forever and ever. Throughout chapter 7, you're going to see receipt of the kingdom and possession of the kingdom separated. Why? Because there's a 45-day period between the receipt of the, between the time the kingdom is awarded officially by Father and the day that they possess the kingdom, the start of the millennium. There's a 45-day period there. Verse 21, I was watching, and the same horn was making war against the saints and prevailing against them. That's the Antichrist during the fifth seal, all the way through to the seventh trumpet. We know that he's prevailing during the sixth trumpet, his 200 million man army. He prevailed until when? Until the Ancient of Days came and a judgment was made in favor of the saints. Okay, that's the seventh trumpet. And the time came for the saints to possess the kingdom. That's 45 days used to gather all nations to the wedding. So they got to be in place. That takes 45 days. Read this. Read chapter 7. All right. Now let's turn over to Daniel 8, which starts right here. Daniel 8 talks about the prophecy known as the 2,300-day prophecy. All right, it's a vision, okay? Then I heard, verse 13 of Daniel 8, then I heard a holy one speaking, and another holy one said to that certain one who was speaking, how long will the vision be concerning the daily sacrifices and the transgression of desolation, the giving of both the sanctuary and the host to be trampled underfoot? How long is all of this? Verse 14, and he said to me, for 2,300 days, then the sanctuary shall be cleansed. Well, guess when the sanctuary is finally cleansed? At Jesus' return, the seventh bowl, the last day of the age, when he breaks through the atmosphere, and it's his wedding day, it's our wedding day. It's going to be an interesting wedding day. It's going to be wonderful. But you're also going to be on that cloud when Jesus is taking that night to defeat his enemies in the whirlwind. And we're going to read about that. What does it look like when Jesus returns? It's all throughout the Bible. We may not look at it in this lesson. This is an introductory lesson. So, the 2,300-day prophecy is a period from, well, let's let the Father tell us. Here we are in the same chapter. Verse 23 starts the vision, the 2,300-day period, okay, from the Antichrist coming on the scene to the time when Jesus comes on the scene in the physical realm in person and takes that crown off the Antichrist's head. That's the period of 2,300 days. Okay, we read about it in verse 13 and 14. Now in verse 23, let's get specific on what's going to occur during those 2,300 days. And in the latter time of their kingdom, when the transgressors have reached their fullness, all right, in other words, the caliphate has turned into the fourth beast kingdom, when they have reached their fullness, a king shall arise, having fierce features who understands sinister schemes. His power shall be mighty, but not by his own power. Why? Because Satan will have taken control of his mind and body. He shall destroy fearfully, and shall prosper and thrive. He shall destroy the mighty and also the holy people. Okay? That's from the fifth seal. That is from the fifth seal to the seventh bowl. But when does this vision of 2,300 days begin? When the king shall arise and be crowned. He's a king. When the Antichrist is crowned, which is the opening of the first seal, when he rides on his horse, we're not talking about caliphate leaders. We're talking about the actual fourth beast kingdom. When it has reached its fullness, that king shall arise. That's the opening of the first seal. That's when you start counting 2,300 days until Jesus himself takes the crown off of the head of the Antichrist and binds him, kills him, but binds the devil. Now, we read on. Verse 25, through his cunning he shall cause the heathen to prosper under his rule, and he shall exalt himself in his heart. Okay, that's mid-trib when he's speaking blasphemies and setting up the image. He shall destroy many in their prosperity. He shall even rise against the prince of princes. All right, he's destroying the bride of Christ. Fifth seal to seventh bowl, but he shall be broken without human means. You got that right. And the vision of the evenings and mornings, which was told, is true. Therefore, seal up the vision, for it refers to many days in the future. How many days? Well, it's been quite a while since Daniel wrote this vision down. But do you understand what stops the 2,300-day prophecy? It's the day that he is broken
without human without human means. That's the Battle of Armageddon. Jesus returns in person, collects up his bride, the wedding takes place, and bam, all you know what breaks out. All right, so that's Daniel 7. That's Daniel 8. Now, the 70th week of Daniel is 7 years long. 7 years is more than 2,300 days. So there's going to be a time period from the start of the 70th week until the Antichrist is crowned. Okay, use your calculator. Multiply 7 times 365 days a year. So you've got a couple hundred days there before the first seal is actually opened. Now, let's match Daniel 11 with this Daniel chapter 8. Turn over to Daniel 11. Again, this is just an introduction. I know I'm going a little deep. Daniel 11, obviously you're going to have to look at your own Bibles. This is getting hard for you to read. But it is, in person for me, it is very easy to read. But on this video, I imagine it's terribly hard for you to read. But looking at Daniel 11 in your own Bibles, okay, the Antichrist shows up on the scene and gets crowned at verse 21. The 70th week of Daniel, 200 days before, begins at verse 20. Okay, verse 20 starts the 70th week. Verse 21 is the opening of the first seal. And in his place shall arise a vile person. That's a clue throughout all scripture of the Antichrist, to whom they will not give the honor of royalty, but he shall come in peaceably and seize the kingdom by intrigue. That's the start of the 2,300-day prophecy. When that happens, the opening of the first seal, you know when your wedding day is. But brother, nobody knows the day or the hour. Well, you don't. I cannot tell you right now what day and what year Jesus will return, and you can't either. But when that first seal is opened, we'll know. Now, will we know when the first seal is opened? Will we know when the Antichrist has been crowned? That's a question. Maybe we won't know the exact day when it happens. I think we will. If we do, we know exactly when Jesus is returning. Then we'll know, not now. Things aren't unsealed yet. And we'll definitely know when the abomination of desolation takes place. Surely we'll know that. But I say that, but with all of the wars that are coming, there may not be a whole lot of electricity to go around. People may be running for their lives up in the hills. I mean, you may not know everything. You may not be able to say, okay, the seal, first seal was opened today. Let's begin counting 2,300 days. When the nuclear power plants are leaking because all of the earth is shaking, and you're spending more time burying the dead than you are even searching for food, it's going to be hard to keep track. But if you do know the day that he's crowned, you can start counting 2,300 days. Okay, the vision was given to us for reason, right? Father does not put his clues in here for not.
Spend time in the Word every day and you'll start unlocking this stuff. He loves you. He wants to give you hope so you can make it with patience until He comes. When these things start taking place, you need all the loving by your groom you can get. All of the hang in there, I'm coming soon. He's giving you clues.
All right, 2,300 days starts verse 21, when the Antichrist is crowned. Now, come to a time known as the appointed time.
verse 29, the appointed time from verse 29 of Daniel 11 until the end of verse 39 of Daniel 11, this is the period between the fifth seal and the end of the fifth trumpet. I say again, verse 29, the appointed time is from the fifth seal through the fifth trumpet. Why? Because verse 40, the time of the end, when many countries shall be overthrown, that is the sixth trumpet. That is the sixth trumpet. Daniel 12 will be the seventh trumpet period that lasts for 45 days. So Daniel 11, verse 40 to 45, that's the sixth trumpet. It's going to last a couple years. When many countries shall be overthrown, 200 million man army going forth during the sixth trumpet. That's it. Now, going back to appointed time, the first four seals of the book of Revelation have already been opened. Back in verse 23, we saw the peace agreement that the horn signed. And after the league is made with him, he shall act deceitfully, for he shall come up and become strong with a small number of people. Okay, that is the ten horns, a peace agreement. Israel's also in this agreement until they start acting, everyone involved starts acting deceitfully. Sunni, Shia, Israeli, nobody can trust anybody. But the appointed time is the fifth seal through the fifth trumpet. What are some of the things we see in this time period called the appointed time? You see the abomination of desolation here in verse 31. You see the persecution of the saints you read about in the fifth seal. Here we go. Those of the people who understand shall instruct many. Okay, you see the Christians falling, being put on trial. Okay, letting the Holy Spirit speak through them, asking, how long, dear Lord, how long? Okay, but wait till the time of the end. Hang in there. Blasphemies are spoken. We know the mark of the beast is going to be going out. Israel's attacked. Israel will fall. Jerusalem will fall. We read about that all throughout the Old Scripture, the Old Testament. And then the time of the end comes, verse 40. This is the sixth trumpet. Read about it. 200 million man army. And then chapter 12 of Daniel is the seventh trumpet period. Michael will stand up. The seventh trumpet will sound. The kingdom will be awarded to the saints. Why? Remember Revelation 12:11? What had to happen? What was the court in Daniel 7 waiting on? To see if the saints were willing to testify and die for Jesus as he died for them. Revelation 12:11, Daniel 7. Keep all of those in mind. Do you remember what the fifth seal says in the book of Revelation, chapter 6? Let's go back and look at that. Revelation, chapter 6. Keep in mind Revelation 12:11, that minimum number of saints that have to be willing to die for Jesus. All right, here we are, Revelation 6. Seal. Revelation chapter 6, verse 9. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. They cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth? Then a white robe was given to each of them,
And it was said to them that they should rest a little while longer until what? Until what? When is Jesus coming back? When is the court going to rule in their favor? Until both the number of their fellow servants and their brethren who would be killed as they were was completed. What is completed? The number who would be killed as they were. Sounds like a lot of beheadings, brothers and sisters. Okay, the method is going to be the same. They're going to be killed as they were. Okay, but what are we waiting on? What is the court in Daniel 7 waiting on? Until both the number of their fellow servants and their brethren would be killed as they were completed. That's what we're waiting on. That's what the court is in session waiting on before Father will reach a verdict at the seventh trumpet. The seventh trumpet blast will be sound. That is the saints being awarded the kingdom. But it takes 45 days to gather the nations of the world's representatives and armies and commanders and kings to the Valley of Armageddon for the revealing of Jesus and the gathering up of his bride. Remember, Revelation 12:11, Revelation 6:11. Remember those and remember Daniel 7. Read it. The time possessed is after the time awarded. All right, going back to look at Daniel 12. We have talked about the 1290 and the 1335, and we mentioned the 1260. Let's tie all that in again to Daniel chapter 12. Oops. All right. Remember what I said. They have the same starting date, the 1290 and the 1335. It is what? The abomination of desolation, which is where in Daniel 11? Right here in verse 31. That's when the 1290 and the 1335 days, which, guess what? You are supposed to start counting. Hello? He didn't make these numbers up, but just give them to us for us to go, we're not going to be here. We don't need to worry about it. Good luck, Jews. Come on, brothers and sisters. Both flocks are in Christ if they're saved. He comes back for his bride once. He's not going to get half his bride 7 years earlier. Throw out the seminary teachings and get into God's word for yourself. Lord, help us. All right. Let's look at verse 9 of Daniel 12. And he said, "Go your way, Daniel, for the words are closed up and sealed till the time of the end." Here, the time of the end is referring to the last 7 years, not the time of the end, sixth trumpet to seventh bowl. "Many shall be purified, made white, and refined, but the wicked shall do wickedly, and none of the wicked shall understand, but the wise shall understand." Not the ones who are being taught in seminary, but the ones who seek God's face every morning between 3 and 5 or 6 in the morning, who start their day out telling God how much they love him and spending time with his son, the Word. The wise shall understand. Understand what? What's 1260? What's 1290? What's 1335? What's 2300? How dare Christians not at least try to understand these?
Well, we don't want to become false teachers. You know what? Do you realize how much effort Father put into all this information he's giving you for you to go, well, I have so much faith that I don't have to, because I'm going to be out of here before any of this happens. Wake up. You need this, and you are going to be here. Why? Because you have a mission. What is your mission? To be delivered up on TV in trial and let the Holy Spirit speak through you in tongues so the whole world can hear the truth. Be willing to die. Sing as they're taking your head off. That brings up another subject, the wrath. How many different types of wrath are there? It's all wrath, and we're not going to be here for any of it. Wrong. The wrath he's talking about is the wrath when your soul is destroyed. You are kept from that wrath, but you're not kept from these 7 years. In fact, he's counting on you. You're his A-team. You're a secret weapon. You're what's being watched by the court in Daniel 7. You need to prepare yourself, brothers and sisters. It's going to be rough. It's take the mark or else. When you're watching a knife at the back of your child's head and you're told if you don't take the mark, your child's going to be killed in front of you, what are you going to say? Well, we don't have to worry. We're not going to be here. Yes, you are. What are you going to say? Now, not everybody on the planet will be forced to go through that test. There's going to be people who will not ever have to take that or die. Hallelujah. How do I know that? Because the Bible is very clear that there's going to be millions of people left on the earth when Jesus gathers up his bride at the seventh bowl. When morning comes and it's over, all who took the mark will be dead. But there'll be plenty throughout the earth who were not saved, were not gathered up, were not put into glorified bodies, but who will be left alive throughout the planet. But the Bible does say that humankinds who are left in their man of dust body will be as rare as the finest gold. There's not going to be a whole lot of people left out of the billions who started this 70th week, but there'll be a few million left here and there. And they will enter the kingdom as men in as man of dust bodies, and they will replenish the earth, and billions of babies will be born, and it'll be wonderful. And the host of heaven will get to see what it's like on earth when Jesus is in charge. But finishing up here with Daniel 12. All right. Verse 11. And from the time that the daily sacrifice is taken away and the abomination of desolation is set up. All right. We saw that is in Daniel 11. Verse 31, that's part of the appointed time period, around the time of the fifth seal. There shall be 1,290 days. Unto what? Until you are awarded the kingdom. But it's not time to possess yet, because when it's time to possess, you arise. You're resurrected if you sleep in Christ, translated if you're alive. If you have your wedding garment on, which is spiritually speaking. Verse 12, blessed, who's the blessed? The elect, the chosen, the bride, the faithful. The ones he foreknew before the foundations of the earth and made sure that they were drawn to Jesus. Matthew 22 says it's an arranged marriage. Hello. Blessed is he who waits, who endures, who has patience, who doesn't give up, even if their knife is at their throat or their loved one's throat, until the end.
Blessed is he who waits and comes to the 1,335 days, but you go your way till the end, for you shall rest, sleep in Christ, and will arise to your inheritance at the end of the days, the end of the age, the seventh bowl, day 1,335 after the abomination of desolation. It's day 2,300 after the opening of the first seal. That's when you arise. Day 1335 after the abomination of desolation. What has thrown the church off all these years are verses that talk about we were not destined to suffer through God's wrath. Well, there's actually three different forms of Father's wrath. All right, you need to know what they are. The final wrath, the ones that we will not have to adore, we will not stand naked before the throne, we will not be ashamed, we will not, our soul will not be put to death at the end of the millennium, we will not have to suffer that wrath because we endure no matter what happens. If we're on trial and we're being threatened with death, we will let the Holy Spirit give witness through us and we'll let him kill us like sheep to the slaughter. That's how the word's going to get out to the Hindus, to the Buddhists. All right? They've got to know the truth. You've got to be willing to die like Jesus was willing to die for you. Amen. We'll go more in detail in the upcoming weeks and months. God bless you, brothers and sisters.